Hey folks, welcome to another SubQuery video where I'm going to take a closer look at SubQuery Explorer. Stick around and find out more. So at the very top here, if I click on Explorer, you should see basically a collection of projects that have been made public to the community. Just a quick recap, you may recall if I click on the projects link here and create a new project, there's a link asking if I want to hide this from the SubQuery Explorer. If I tick this, it means that it won't be available, it won't be visible in the Explorer page. So if you leave this unticked, it means it will appear here. And at the top, we've got some featured projects, and then down below, the remaining collection of community projects. You can search for a particular project by keyword and also by the network that it supports as well. So let's go ahead and jump into any of these projects and we'll do a quick analysis. I'll choose, say, Dawinia. This looks pretty interesting. I can first of all hit play just to make sure that it still works and that data is being returned, and indeed it is. And if you are a front-end coder, for example, you can actually consume this API and make use of the data coming back. But what I want to do is analyze two specific areas. One is around the GitHub or the code, and the second one is around the documentation down here. So let's first of all jump into the GitHub repository. And the first thing that I do is I always check out the schema.graphql file. In other words, I'm looking at the shape of the data in terms of what can be queried upon. Here we've got block as an entity, we've got extrinsic, event. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 entities or 6 objects, and I can access the various fields from within. So for transfer, I've got from to, token amount, etc. For account, I've got transfer total count. For event, I've got my index, section, data, timestamp, etc. So this gives me a very high level overview of the information I can extract and the objects involved. Going back, the next file that I'm interested in is the manifest file. So here you can see we've got 3 handlers, the block, event, and the call handler. You can see the block handler has a filter, and the start block is around 4.5 million. We do have an endpoint here, which is the Dawinia.network destination. And information down below here, this refers to a custom chain, which I haven't talked about yet, but I will be covering in a future video. So let's ignore this for now. And the final thing I want to look at is in the source directory. This gives me an idea of the coding structure, the hierarchy or architecture. Normally, everything is included in the mapping handler file, but as your project gets larger, you may want to split it into different files and different folder structures. Here you can see we've got the handle block, event, and the call function, and each one of these instantiates a new class. So you can imagine we've actually got a block handler function, event handler, an extrinsic handler function somewhere in the code as well. If I go back to the source directory, if I click on the handler, click on the block, this is where the block handler class is defined. And in here you can see I've got the functions that we've seen before: get block timestamp, get number, get hash, etc. So this is where the actual data from the blockchain is obtained, and then it's returned when someone calls, for example, the number function. Now I'll jump back into the sources folder and you'll also see other helper functions here. For example, this one shows get block timestamp as well. So I won't go too deep into the structure, but different programmers structure their code in different ways depending on the size of the project and the complexity as well. So if I go back to the actual project here, this time let's focus on the Documentation Explorer on the right-hand side. It's actually an important skill to understand how to read the documentation. I actually find this one here slightly confusing. What I prefer to do is clone the actual code itself and then run it in my local host in a Docker environment, for example, because the documentation and the schema tab feels a little clearer to me. However, we can still use this, for example, to search, say, the accounts schema. So let's go accounts. And what you'll probably see is that for accounts, if I click on this, this reads and enables pagination through a set of account, the singular. So what I want to do is find the singular option here. And if I scroll down, you can see I've got ID and transfer total account, which is what the two fields here are. If I go to extrinsic, for example, let's go extrinsic, this one here, and this is of type extrinsic connection. So if I click on this and traverse through the nodes, you should see I end up at ID, method, section, args, etc. And these are the fields available to me on the extrinsic object. Now this should be familiar because we saw all of these in the actual code itself along with the schema file. So I can go ahead and include, say, timestamp and maybe block ID here. So let's go time. And you can see the autocomplete appear as well. So let's go block ID and hit run. And we should see the timestamp and the block ID appear. So when starting out, this can be a bit tricky to understand. How do we query for data? And I've shown two techniques here. The first one is jumping into the open source code itself, where we can see, looking at the schema file, the type of information we can extract. And the second way is to use the documentation. However, this one here, to me, is not as intuitive as the one that you see when you're running locally. So there you have it, a very quick overview of what the SubQuery Explorer is, and when clicking into a project, how to understand what that project actually does. Hope this video was useful, and I'll catch you on the next one.